Welcome to NonstopNeuron.com, where learning medical concepts is as easy as watching cartoons.
In this part 2 of local control of blood flow, we will complete the long-term control mechanisms. In part 1, we saw that mechanisms involved in local control of blood flow can be broadly divided into two categories: short-term control mechanisms and long-term control mechanisms. The short-term mechanisms respond within seconds to minutes. They bring about changes in blood flow by causing constriction or dilatation of existing vessels. But these mechanisms are not effective if the changes in blood flow are needed on a long-term basis. And that's why there is a team of long-term control mechanisms too. They come into action if the demand for blood flow is increased for days to weeks or longer. And they bring about the changes in blood flow by affecting the number and size of the vessels. It's like the long-term control people are the builders of the vessels. They build or destroy vessels. And the short-term regulation guys are the operators of the vessels. They control the flow of blood in existing vessels. Now, in long-term regulation, we basically have three mechanisms: angiogenesis, development of collaterals, and remodeling of existing vessels. First, let's talk about angiogenesis. Angio means blood vessel, and genesis means formation. So angiogenesis literally means the formation of new blood vessels. To study this, let's take some generic tissue along with its vascular supply. Now, angiogenesis occurs when the demand for blood flow is increased for a prolonged period. Or in other words, the cells stay hungry for days to weeks. Such an increase in demand may occur in multiple conditions like physical training, acclimatization to high altitude, during the menstrual cycle, in tumors, inflammation, and during healing. In such conditions, the deficiency of oxygen or other nutrients causes the formation of Bob the Builder. I mean formation of angiogenic factors. Important angiogenic factors are vascular endothelial growth factor, or VEGF for short, fibroblast growth factor, platelet-derived growth factor, and angiogenin. These factors diffuse into their surroundings and reach the existing vessels. From here, the process of formation of blood vessels begins. First, the basement membrane is dissolved. Then, the endothelial cells in the vessels multiply and protrude from the vessels. This way, a cord of cells grows towards the source of the angiogenic factor. The cells in these cords also keep dividing and fold over into tubes. Such growth occurs at multiple sites, including the other end of the capillary bed too. Near the source, the growing tubes from both the sides merge, and thus a capillary is formed. The blood starts to flow from this capillary, which ultimately brings more nutrients to the tissue. If the flow through such capillaries keep increasing, the smooth muscles also invade the wall. Such capillaries grow into larger vessels like arterioles or venules. Thus, a long-term increase in demand of nutrients causes the formation of new blood vessels. This was angiogenesis. Opposite to this, if the demand is decreased for a long time, the vascularity is decreased. For this, there are anti-angiogenic factors like angiostatin and endostatin. They inhibit angiogenesis. Some other substances, like some steroid hormones, can even destroy existing vessels. Thus, the blood vessels can be destroyed also if they are not needed anymore. So, this is how the blood vessels are created or destroyed as needed. In general, the extent of this reconstruction depends on the underlying tissue. In growing tissues, like in neonates, healing areas, and in cancerous tissues, it occurs faster, and also the vascularity almost matches the need of the tissue. Means it fulfills the increased demand almost completely. On the other hand, in already grown or old tissues, it occurs slowly. Also, the changes might not fulfill the demand completely in such tissues. So this was all about angiogenesis. Now let's talk about the development of collateral circulation. This is usually seen when an artery or vein is blocked. The block impairs the perfusion downstream to the point of the blockage. In such a case, initially the branches arising upstream to the block dilate. This process starts within minutes and starts providing extra blood to some extent. More collaterals keep developing and almost fulfill the demand within few days. The formation of new vessels also occurs during this. Thus, collaterals contribute in short term as well as long term. The immediate dilatation helps in the initial stages, and the formation of new vessels help over the long term. The development of collaterals play a very important role in coronary circulation. So this was about collateral circulation. Now let's talk about vascular remodeling. If you know about tissue remodeling in general, this is the same thing but in blood vessels. Remodeling is basically changes in tissue to adapt to new conditions. For blood vessels, new conditions mainly include changes in the tension in the vessel wall and changes in the blood flow in the lumen. Tension depends on the radius of the blood vessel and blood pressure. In general, an increase in wall tension causes hypertrophy and increased wall thickness. This allows vessels to withstand more tension. And changes in blood flow affects the diameter of the vessel. This allows the vessel to accommodate the flow as needed. Okay, but these are the general things. To be specific, depending on what exactly the new condition is, different combinations of these changes produce different types of remodeling. The first two types are seen in response to chronic changes in blood pressure, and the other two are in response to changes in blood flow. First, let's see what happens with changes in pressure. Chronic increase in pressure produces different effects in small arteries and arterioles and in large arteries. In small vessels, the rise in pressure causes their constriction. If you are wondering why the hell the small vessels would do that, it's autoregulation, which is important to prevent unnecessary changes in blood flow with changing arterial pressure. If high blood pressure lasts for a long time, the small vessels start to remodel to adapt to this new condition. In this, their smooth muscles rearrange themselves in this new position. Here, the total cross-section area of the vessel wall remains the same, but the diameter of the lumen is decreased. In simple words, this constricted state becomes their new default position. This way, they prevent an increase in blood flow inherently without going through the headache of constriction. This is called inward eutrophic remodeling. So this is the response of small arteries and arterioles. Before we move to large arteries, please note that the small vessels constricted in response to increased pressure. Thus, the fall in radius and rise in pressure compensated for each other. So tension remains almost the same as earlier. But in large arteries, the tension is increased. See, the large arteries do not constrict in response to the rise in pressure. So in them, the tension is increased. To withstand this increased tension, their smooth muscles undergo hypertrophy. So the vessel wall gets thicker than before. Because of this, the cross-section area of the vessel wall is increased in this case. This is called hypertrophic remodeling. Such remodeling is also seen in a vein that is used for coronary artery bypass grafting. As such, the veins operate at a lower pressure, and they have thin walls. But when it is connected to the arterial system, it encounters increased pressure. So the tension in their walls increases, which leads to hypertrophy. So these were remodelings in response to increased pressure. The next two remodeling types are seen in response to chronic changes in blood flow. Fistula connecting a large artery and a large vein is a good example to study these changes. Here we have a schematic diagram of the radial artery and antecubital vein in the forearm. Normally, the blood flows as usual from the artery to capillaries to the vein. But in patients with renal failure, a fistula is created from radial artery to the antecubital vein to allow dialysis. So the blood from artery directly enters the vein. As the small vessels like capillaries are bypassed in this route, the resistance is decreased, so the flow is increased. So the artery and vein both face increased blood flow. This increases shear stress, which causes the diameter of blood vessels to increase. For the artery, this is the only change. The diameter increases, but the thickness of the wall remains unchanged. This is called outward remodeling. So this is the response of the artery. Remember, the artery is experiencing only one change, an increase in blood flow. But the vein experiences two changes. In addition to the increase in blood flow, it's also exposed to higher pressure. This is because high pressure blood from the artery is directly entering the vein now. And now you know the drill for pressure as well. The pressure increases tension, which causes hypertrophy. This, combined with increase in diameter, gives an overall picture like this. Increased flow causes outward remodeling, and increased tension causes hypertrophic remodeling. So we have a combo here called outward hypertrophic remodeling. So these were all the responses to the increase in blood pressure and flow. A decrease in pressure and flow produces opposite effects. Chronic fall in pressure causes thinning of the vessel wall, and chronic fall in blood flow causes the lumen of the vessel to get narrower. So these were all the mechanisms of long-term regulation of local blood flow. Now let's have a quick summary. When the nutrient demand for the tissue is increased for a long time, various control mechanisms try to fulfill this demand by bringing about changes in size and number of the blood vessels. Angiogenesis creates new vessels. Block in the vessels causes the development of collaterals in the channels that are still connected. And the remodeling adapts the vessel wall to the new conditions. That's it for this video. For sticking with me until the end, here is a bonus point for you. It's another metaphor for short-term and long-term regulation. Short-term regulation is like medical treatment. Like medicines, it targets the physiology of the vessels and it's short-lasting. Whereas long-term regulation is like surgical treatment. It targets the anatomy of the vessels and produces lasting changes. Now, finally, that's it for this video. Please share it with your friends and colleagues too. Thanks for watching. See you in the next video.